Welcome to Mindset, where we journey through the realms of mind and body to unlock the full potential of human wellness. Join your host, Alex Muir, as we explore transformative health hacks, debunk myths, and empower you with knowledge straight from the experts. Dive into each episode ready to flex your mind, body, and soul, because your ultimate well-being journey starts right here.
Mindset podcast. This is your host Alex Muir, helping you flex your mind, body, and soul. Today's episode 111, we're going to be speaking with general physician Dr. Torkil Faero. Super pumped to have you on the Mindset podcast.
And thank you, Alex.
We've got a lot to talk about. We got a lot to dive into, and your background in heart rate variability is incredible. And your book, you're the author of the book The Pulse Cure. And then you've got quite the interesting background, right? General practitioner, emergency physician, documentary filmmaker, and then author and photographer. And then again, you're from Norway. You're part of one of the first Norwegian medics to work for Doctors Without Borders. So the work that you're doing, and again, this all spans across a 25-year career, is incredible. So welcome to the Mindset Podcast. Happy to have you on. I'm trying to get more Europeans on my show. I want the Mindset brand to go global, to really reach wide and far. So super pumped to have you on the show. Welcome.
Cool.
And let's start off by talking about, like, what is heart rate variability and why does it matter, you know, more so to our health?
Yeah. So heart rate variability is the variation between heartbeats. And that's important because I can tell you whether you are in the stressed fight and flight state, the sympathetic state, or in the parasympathetic, restful, restorative state. So it's super important in our time because so many of the diseases that we are struggling with as doctors and patients, they are based on too much stress in our lives and too little rest, too little downtime, too little sleep. And when we have these wearables that can track heart rate variability, we have an instrument that works like a speedometer, so we can track our health and regulate our autonomic nervous system. So yeah, it's super important just for not only for health, but also for well-being and longevity. And so heart rate variability is connected to almost every disease you can think of, and including death of all causes. So it's just a super important metric.
And when I was reading a little bit about your book there, like, and just like perusing through it, you talk about kind of how heart rate variability affected your dad. And I know it's affected my dad as well. So making sure the heart is really healthy and strong is something that's super important to me. So as soon as I saw that you specialize in that and that's part of your background, I was like, oh, I have to interview this doctor. So
yeah, and heart rate variability is not only predictive of heart disease, but of cancer, of dementia, of stroke, and so many other things, because it's a measure of the pressure on your body, on your immune system. So if your heart rate variability is low, that will be that your heart beats very steadily as a sign that you are in a stress mode. Then the immune system is underperforming and laying ground for all kinds of diseases, including heart disease. And so many people actually tell me through Instagram or other places that they have discovered heart disease just by using the wearables and going to the doctor and then finding out that, okay, you're on the verge of getting a heart attack here and you need to go to the ICU. So yeah, so it's important, very life, potentially life-saving, both on short term like that you can see that, okay, that there's something really troubling you right now that is dangerous, but low grade stress over time also is a big problem.
Yeah. And I saw that you came up with your own device that you've been wearing, your own wearable. And how's that been working? Because I see you constantly posting your stats. Yeah. When it looks pretty flashy. And when, like, let's say a night of intense exercise, great sleep, compared to a night of pizza, maybe having a glass of wine, how crazy different our heart rate is.
There's not much more pizza anymore or wine. I'm telling you, and I used to love just that. So I remember when I was doing my internship, I was actually eating so much pizza that the pizza boxes, you know, stacked up, and we needed to be two people carrying out all the empty pizza boxes out into the trash. So I used to love pizza and wine, but once you start tracking the heart rate variability and see the physiological price of this, then I reduced it dramatically. So I probably have pizza like five times a year, and maybe alcohol as well, five times a year. Particularly now after the success of my book, you know, it's been a huge bestseller in Norway and translated into seven languages. And so now I have to really keep my stress levels in balance. So, because again,
very useful. Yeah. Cause a lot of people are gaining a lot of value from it. And like, you're like, part and parcel of your, of like, you know, like what you're sharing with the world, right? How to improve heart health and using heart rate variability to do it. Cause it's a great indicator and preventer from, potentially catastrophic heart failure, right? And another thing that I've seen on the Fitbit, because they keep getting better and better with it and adding more and more metrics and biomarkers to be able to detect things with the heart. And one of the other ones which is factored into my metrics is called like the irregular heartbeat. So, right? Heart arrhythmia, I think it's called. Yeah. Is that right? Yeah. So when it's like, it'll be like, boo doo doo doo. And it's just, it's gotten off beat. So if I ever have that, it does have a detection in there. Like if I'm like, if it's too much. So, but one other thing I want to talk to you about, which I'm interested to get a physician's perspective on it, is like pre-workout supplements. Like I used to take them a lot when I was younger, and I really only have coffee, right? Like two cups of coffee a day, sometimes just one. But occasionally, I need a little bit of extra caffeine, right? Because I'm just tired from the day or responsibilities or whatever is going on, personal family obligations. So what, I don't know if it's as popular in Norway, but like what kind of stuff do you see with people taking pre-workouts, you know, let's say either frequently or seldomly on heart health? Because I know it does put a stress on your heart a little bit.
Yeah. I'm not sure, really. It's not my area of expertise, but I know that caffeine would be a good thing pre-exercise, or so I hear when I listen to Andrew Huberman and so on, that this is a good thing. And according to Whoop, one of the devices that are the experts on heart rate variability, then coffee is a good thing in itself. So many people are worried, is coffee bad for me? But as long as you drink it in the morning, maybe stop drinking it after 12 or 1 p.m., it's a good thing. Once you start drinking coffee later in the afternoon, it will disturb sleep. Even if you think it does not, it does. When they check in sleep labs, they can see that even though you're asleep and you're able to sleep with the caffeine, the sleep is not as effective as without. But more than that, I don't really know. I usually work out now. I'm training for the New York Marathon this November, and I just have a couple of cups of coffee, and then I go out running on an empty stomach. So maybe it would be good to have. I hear some people say that if you drink like a Red Bull or a battery, that can be good for the result, but for the heart health, I'm not sure. Exercising hard is not good for heart health. So there's kind of a dosage of exercise that you need to, it does not need to be too hard. Like when after a marathon, when they have done blood tests, they have seen that half of the marathon runners will have elevated troponin, which is a biomarker for heart damage. So I think that the sweet spot for exercising for your health, that would be maybe 3-4 hours a week in a moderate and not too hard, not getting over into the zone 4 and 5, but try to do most of your exercise in zone 2. That is what I'm trying to do anyway, and that is what the best athletes also do. So even the ones in the Olympics, in bicycling and running, they will have like 80% of their exercise in zone 2, but for a longer time.
No, I like that, because the way I would used to train, it would be like an hour a day of weights, or 45, let's say 45 minutes of weights. And sometimes I'd put cardio in there too, for like elliptical for 15 or 20 minutes. But that was in my 20s, and now I'm in my 30s. And, you know, it's like they say, like you have all this energy, and when you're training like really young, right? Like it's just like, oh my God, like your recovery is through the roof. And then it starts to, you need more time to recover, right? You got to listen to your body more. Yeah. So, but I'm a big fan of high intensity interval training, because I know it's a lot harder and it's a lot more intense, but that's why I only do it 2 to 3 times a week. So is that okay?
Yeah, you must. That would be okay. Particularly if you get enough rest in between there.
Yeah.
So the advantage, I'm not sure. And it's some time since I tried the Fitbit, but the Garmin watch will give you an estimate of your recovery time.
Right.
So, I think as long as it's 1 day or a day and a half, that should be okay. Most people that are not athletes, they would probably need to restrict their recovery time to 24 hours.
Yeah.
So that you don't exercise more than that you are recovered into the next day. So, but I think that if you do high intensity training, at least there should be one day off in between there, to make sure that you recover properly. And if you don't do that, you're not getting the payback for your exercise anyway. No. So you want to wait until the body has built itself stronger before you again put more load on it. So so people that use HRV to track their exercise regimen, they find that when they do it according to HRV, they can train less and they perform better.
Yeah, and so, that's exactly what I'm trying to do as I'm aging, right? More listening to the body, and like, because Fitbit does have a recovery score.
They've just
released that, I'd say, in the last year or something like that. So I've actually been really paying attention to that, because in conjunction with, you know, the daily movement, right? Because like you said, I always give myself 24, sometimes even 48 hours or more between sessions if my last session was super intense. So I will look at my recovery score, and a lot of times it's actually quite good. But even though sometimes I might still feel like gassed still, I'll be like, okay, I need to just focus on mobility today. And that's what I did yesterday, because I trained on, what is it today? Sunday. Yeah. So I did train on Friday. I did an intense working on Friday. So like yesterday, so today will be like hiking focused out in nature. And then yesterday it was just 15 minutes of mobility, nice and light. So
Do you know your VO2 max? Do you get that on your Fitbit?
I can't recall again, because how do you do the calculation for the VO2
max? The Garmin does it in their systems, so that I get a reading from my watch, and that is accurate, because I did one treadmill test, you know, in a lab, and it was like 43.5, and my watch showed 44. So for most people, it's quite accurate. So, and that's an important metric to know, because if that is really low, that if you're in a poor fitness level, and maybe you have a VO2 max of 30, you know, a lot of people have that if they haven't exercised, then just an easy jog will give you like 4 days of recovery time. So it's really useful, particularly if you're not used to exercising.
Yeah, there's also a like a YouTuber called Julia.Reppel. She's German, and she's got a BA in exercise sports science. So, and I watched all of her. I do all of her mobility videos. So it's her. There's also Breathe and Flow on YouTube that are really good. And
all right.
But it's cool, because she's super like. Because she trains for half marathon, she's done an ultra marathon, and she like documents it on YouTube, so it's pretty cool. So but yeah, she talks about like all that kind of stuff, and then she shows her like with the apparatus on, doing like that full-on physical assessment.
Yeah, and that is really hard. You know, when you test for your VO2 max, you're just running at your maximum for like 8 minutes. Yeah. And doing that gives you 4 days, at least for me, 4 days of recovery time.
That's insane.
And I can really see it in my HRV as well, that it really is a big strain in my system for 4 days when you have 8 minutes running. And if I run in zone two, you know, with 130, 140 in heart rate, I can run for probably a couple of hours without getting into that level. So intense exercise is really hard on our systems.
Yeah, no, it definitely is. And like, I like how you talked about the zone two, because Peter Attia talks about that in his podcast and Andrew Huberman's podcast, because like that extra strain on the system from exercising too intensely, too frequently. I've definitely fallen into that and needed so much extra time to recover. So,
yeah. And many people, unfortunately, if they have busy lives and then they think that, okay, I'm just exercising once or twice a week, okay, then I have to push it real hard, you know, that may be too much. And you're getting cytokines in your system and inflammation, and it may not be very, very smart. So it's important to, you know, to balance the intensity of your exercise to the totality of your stress levels.
Yeah. So when you say exercise 3 to 4 hours a week at zone two, that's like, what does that equate to? Is that like, oh yeah, so 3 or 4 days a week, like for an hour, like kind of a thing?
Yeah.
Or 30 minutes? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So maybe 1 hour, 3 or 4 times a week. Yeah. Not more than that, I think, for your health.
Yeah.
Of course, if you want to perform and win your game and run faster, then it may be too little, but to have optimal health effects of it, then that may be the sweet spot.
And within that 3 to 4 hours, or let's say 3 to 4 sessions a week, is that like weight training, mobility, and cardio? Like anaerobic combined?
Or both. So I do 2 or 3 runs a week, and then 1 day of strength training. That's what I do. So
nice. And then what's your training protocol look like since you're preparing your body for the New York Marathon?
I'm testing out how little can I train to be able to run a marathon. So I'm actually trying not to run faster than 5 hours, you know, which is quite a long time. But I'm trying to run for half an hour, 2 or 3 times a week, and see if that will get me in good enough shape. And so far, it seems good. And the reason why I do that is because life is so busy right now with all the popularity of the book and so on, that I can't spend too much energy on recovery after training. So if I train so hard that I run 20 minutes faster, then I've done a not so smart thing, because I will underperform at writing my book and being with my family. I will use too much energy on recovery, and I don't have that time right now. So I'm trying to run only in zone two and keep my heart rate at least below 150 while I'm running. So. So that's an interesting experiment. Everybody knows that you can run a marathon if you train really hard, but I'm going to check out if I can do it if I train very little, or, you know, so we'll see.
I've heard of that too, of when I was like, you know, on the treadmill and stuff like that, trying to get back into running, because I was always a runner. I was like, when I was playing all my sports in high school and stuff, it was like, I think it was like about 30 to 40K a week, which is it's not a lot, like for some of these people that do marathons and stuff, because they're really logging the miles. But the thing that I've heard is, yeah, they keep that same like pace. They're not raising the intensity at all, because if they raise the intensity, like you said, their recovery, they got to spend so much extra time recovering. So, but it's
And then they use these lactate tests, you know, to check that they're under the lactate threshold. And that is important. So I can see that when I run, and the Garmin will give me a measure of the anaerobic strain. So when I keep under the anaerobic strain level, then I don't need a lot of recovery time.
No, for sure. And what inspired you to write your book, The Pulse Cure?
I just saw that getting your stress levels in balance is so important. And I was initially in it just for my own health, that I wanted to live longer and have more adventures, go out and travel and live longer than my dad. So that was my way into it. And then my publisher became aware that I was doing this and asked me if it was a book for them. This is Norway's biggest publisher. I thought, yes, this is a very weird thing, because this is actually the world's first guidebook on how to use wearables to track your health. So it was not, I didn't have any books to read, you know, to help me. So I had to find these ways and the advice in the book myself. And it proved to be a very, very popular book, because it works. These devices work. They help a lot of people that are on the verge of burnout. That is so common. Many people have fatigue, you know, they have autoimmune diseases, migraines, headaches, muscle pains, underperform and struggle in their lives. And once they're able to regulate their stress levels, they feel better, perform better, and tell everybody about it, you know, through Instagram and everywhere. So it has really been a surprise for the publisher. You know, it was kind of a dark horse. They had never heard of this, you know, using your heart rate to track your stress levels. So they did not expect really anything, and then just kind of exploded. So been on the bestseller charts for a year and a half. So it's been a fun ride.
Congrats. That's amazing. And it's really at a time like in North America as well. Like when you sent me your video lecture, I watched it. And then when you're doing that side by side of society, like whatever in the 1900s or 1700s, or sorry, maybe even farther back than that, like, right. Like the fear back then was, because we're always moving, we're hunters and gatherers. Like we're getting all the movement, and that wasn't the issue. It was constantly getting disease, because we didn't have the medicine and the level of knowledge that we have today of how to, you know, counteract all those diseases that were plaguing the earth. But now on the flip side, we're in a state of chronic inflammation, and that's all part and parcel of diet, lifestyle choices, sleep, level of exercise, and it creates that chronic inflammation, like you said, but it all stems from our stress levels, our cortisol being out of control. So it's just very interesting how our human biology, our physiology has evolved from, like, you know, being very active. We come from very active background, but we've just become very sedentary and highly stressed.
we do kind of everything wrong, you know, so we just have to take more into consideration the conditions where our physiology was developed, you know, under the sun, you know, out in nature, sleeping in the night, you know, it was dark anyway, you couldn't do anything, moving in the daytime to get the food, to hunt the game, you know, to share with your family, being together all the time, you know, being outside in temperature that was cold and warm, and it was just a totally different lifestyle. And now our lifestyle is exactly the opposite. You know, we're eating from the morning until the evening. We're eating ultra processed food that our stomach and intestinal system is not equipped to deal with. We are either training too hard or too little. We are not sleeping enough. We are not resting enough. So we're doing basically everything wrong. We're inside, not too much time in nature, not getting enough sun. So, and we are alone, you know, we're so much more alone. And it's a big, big stressor on our system. Maybe the biggest stressor on our system, that we're alone. Feeling lonely is as dangerous as smoking 15 cigarettes a day, you know. And in addition to that, you know, we drink alcohol. That is really the worst thing for our bodies. So, that is something that everybody see once they start tracking their heart rate variability with the wearables. They see the effect of alcohol, and they're just shocked. You know, it's just shocked. You know, by what they see. You know, so
I like, like when you're talking about alcohol, like don't get me wrong, like I like to have my, you know, glass of wine. I drink really minimally. But I see the impact and the devastation to my sleep when I have just a few, you know, like one night of drinking. It's like insane. You look at the spikes of how much longer it takes you to fall asleep, and then how the impact of how frequently you actually wake up, or your, cause like,
yeah, and your heart rate, you know, is so high, and your heart rate variability is so low. So, so it's a big, big struggle. And after you have been drinking, and it can take 5 days to recover. So when Whoop that tracks their, a lot of athletes, they can see that it will take 5 days. If they go out on a Saturday night, you know, then it will take 5 days until their performance is back again where it was.
So it's like drinking liquid inflammation.
Yeah. You're drinking inflammation, you know. So it's and when you see that, then you start wondering whether the pleasure of these two drinks is worth, you know, the pain of it. So and when you see the physiological price of it in your device, on your wearable, then it's so much more easier to make the good judgments, you know, because sometimes you want to, you know, you're in a wedding or it's a special occasion with your friends, and you think that you will do it. And then when you have the wearable, then at least you know that the day after you should not put more strain on yourself. You have already put enough strain just drinking the alcohol, so you should not go running or doing anything very, very, very stressful the day after to let yourself recover.
So when you wrote the Pulse Cure, is that when you went cold turkey on drinking, or did you do it like well before that, just because of how you were feeling? And
yeah, I had discovered it like 5 years before that. I've done all the mistakes in my book. You know, I used to weigh 40 pounds more than I do today, did not exercise, did not care about sleep or diet, that was drinking alcohol every day, was using nicotine in smoking and different forms. So I really did everything wrong. But the way I discovered alcohol was that I'm often working in the districts of Norway and working for 7 days straight, day and night. I'm on call day and night for 7 days. And then I have one day off, and then I have 7 more days of work. And on the day off, I used to drink a bottle of wine, you know, to relax and to enjoy the evening. And then quite quickly, I understood that I'm more tired after one day off with a bottle of wine than 7 days at work, you know. And then I understood that there's something wrong here. So I actually discovered it before I had the wearables. But of course, after I got the wearables, I've been testing it sometimes, and it's just devastating. So I cannot drink alcohol. If I have 4 glasses of wine, I'm just useless for a couple of days.
Yeah, that's so accurate. Like, it really devastates your sleep. And yeah, talking about recovery, that's been on my mind a lot, and of how it impacts the recovery. Cause I know I already have to recover longer now because of my age, but I'm like, if I add alcohol in the mix, it just exacerbates the problem even more. And you've already talked about a little bit about how the autonomic nervous system relates to HRV, but what are some common lifestyle factors that can negatively impact HRV?
Yeah, of course, alcohol, as we were telling about. Also, if you're eating too much ultra-processed food, that will show. And also, if you're eating late meals, you should stop eating anything, you know, from maybe 3 or 4 hours before you go to bed, and not eat anything after that. A lot of people, they will see that they have some food intolerances. Because if you don't tolerate gluten very well, or egg or milk or a lot of other different things, the heart rate will react to it, so that you can see that your heart rate goes up. So a lot of people see that even if they do everything in the book and still there's a lot of stress, then quite often there's a food intolerance that will keep them stressed. And once they start to fix that, maybe they go to a lab, you know, to get some blood work done and find out what it is. And once they quit that particular ingredient, a lot of people say that, you know, 20 years of muscle pain and bloating and headache and whatever is just gone. So that's one thing. And of course, exercising too hard. And also, a lot of people are just too busy. They just think that they're machines and don't need rest. You know, just wearing their business like a badge of honor and just pushing through. And that can work out well in your 20s, but once you go into your 30s and 40s, you're not your body is not capable of recovering from that. So you will end up contracting some kind of disease or problem with the autoimmune system and so on. So we just need to balance this a lot better, to have more downtime. And the big advantage of the downtime is it's not wasted time. You know, the downtime is the creative time. It's when you get the ideas. It's when you get the reflections. So actually, the people, the psychologists who study the best performers, athletes or writers or artists or business people, they find that the ones that are better at resting, taking naps, taking downtime, taking vacations, they also perform better. So I even read yesterday that the people who work 60 hours a week, they perform at the level of people who work 5 hours a week. You know, so there's kind of a U-shaped curve where the best maybe is like 15 hours a week of concentrated work. Once you start working harder than that, it's counterproductive. You're producing less, you're working harder and getting more stressed, and you're working, but you're not producing the same quality or the same useful quality from your work.
Yeah, your work quality goes like way down. I've heard that too. Yeah, you're just like, it's like this, and then steep decline after so many hours. Yeah. And I like how you talk about like when you're in nature and when you're taking, set aside time for vacations. I always feel like especially because me and my wife love to travel, coming back from a nice vacation, I feel so rejuvenated, and then I can feel like I can go dive into my work.
And you may have a better idea for what to do, you know, and so that you can work less but smarter. Yeah,
I like it. And then we've talked a lot about that. Why don't you share a success story, maybe even a recent one, or one that was, you know, along the way when someone read your book and like, Dr. Torkil, holy smokes, like I made this shift or I made this change, an absolute game changer. What are you hearing from some of your case studies?
I would say for so many women, you know, the PMS, the week before menstruation, is real hard. And in the heart rate variability, we can see that the downshift in heart rate variability is as hard as having COVID. So it's a real physiological strain on your system the week before menstruation, if you have a generally high stress level. Because when you have a high stress level, a lot of cortisol in your system, it disturbs the progesterone production from your hypothalamus and from your gonads, and then you feel worse. It's a strain on your system. And once you start tracking your HRV and you understand that it's the week before menstruation and you start to mitigate the stress, that you train less, you put in more meditation, more breath work, you sleep more, then they're able to flatten out that curve from the stress of the PMS, and the symptoms are so much less. So that a lot of girls in the fertile age that will see this, and they've become much better at regulating their systems.
No, that's really interesting to hear. Yeah, because I noticed that too. Like, especially when my wife's already a little bit stressed, and then before menstruation, like
I even seen curves from the boyfriends of these girls that you can see the same downturn, you know, in the heart rate variability that the stress from the girl, you know, will almost be contagious for the guys, you know, who steps more lightly, you know, and tries to
that's interesting. That's really interesting. I like it, and I like how it's like, yeah, like heart rate variability related to the menstruation before menstruation.
And then, for women, I think if it's one specialty in medicine that should care about heart rate variability, it's the gynecologists and the obstetricians, because heart rate variability is connected to endometriosis, is connected to fertility, it's connected to polycystic ovary syndrome, is connected to the different cancers from the reproductive organs. And is connected to the menopause and perimenopause. So for women, it's actually even more useful than for men, I would say.
No, for sure. And how do you see like heart rate variability monitoring evolving in the next decade or so? Like, what do you see that's kind of on the forefront or changes that might be occurring?
I think the devices are already good enough, you know. So it's, they have kind of already at their like 80% potential already. So the difference will be that it will be much more known. So it will be commonplace to know your HRV to know that it's an important metric. And just like when you're driving your car, you know your speed, you know, and you know how much gas is left in the tank, or how much electricity if you have an electric car. So it will be very normal to have some kind of wearable that will keep this system in track. Maybe it will be become more accurate, you know. Like now, most of the wearables use light to see the pulse, but maybe they will have kind of a pad, you know, close to your heart that will transmit it to the watch or something that will increase the accuracy from probably like 96 to 99 or so, you know. That may be it. And probably the big difference will be artificial intelligence. You know, there's so much artificial intelligence involved already, but maybe you can see that maybe you can just take a picture of your food from your watch and it will see what you're eating, and it will take that into consideration when it sees your heartbeat, and it will give you more accurate advice and see that, okay, you cannot tolerate eggs really well, you know, or something, that information from your device coupled to what you're doing with artificial intelligence will be more useful, even more useful than it is now.
Yeah, like I definitely see it. Yeah, revolutionizing healthcare, and like that, like if they could go that route, and like before we eat a meal, kind of like the blood glucose monitoring, because I know that's not always accurate, but when I've heard when people have used that protocol for a short time, they really start to understand. Oh, I was listening to a podcast, and a guy is a personal trainer that I know, and he loved Greek salads, and then he would eat a Greek salad, and he did his blood glucose, and he's like, oh my God, it's through the roof. He's like, I can't have Greek salad, obviously. Right. So it was interesting. He was him and his girlfriend at the time were talking about their findings, and because they're both personal trainers, and it was just interesting to see, like, it could be the most healthy meals, but if the wrong ingredients are in those meals, then, or the dressings and stuff like that, it can really inflate your blood glucose. So,
Yeah, and CGM is really useful too. So, and maybe the wearables will also include the blood sugar measurements after a while. I think that will be possible. And the big thing about all this is that it shifts the power over your health from the doctor and from the healthcare system and into your own hands. And it shifts it from waiting until you're sick before doing anything to being preventative, proactive instead of reactive. So it's a huge shift, you know, in for the whole healthcare system to use these wearables, so that you're able to, if you want to, you know, a lot of people, they're not motivated or they don't care. you know, probably 70% of the population, they will never bother, you know, they will sit in front of the TV and have their pizza and beer and die 15, 20 years early. They will probably do that still. But anyway, now that there's a possibility for those interested in taking charge of their health to do that. So,
yeah,
so like that's very new.
Being able to turn things around and have a total lifestyle shift and then lengthen your life, your health span and your lifespan. Like, that's the way I kind of like to think now, is like longevity, right? Mm. Will this benefit me longevity wise? Cause I want to be able to have like my kids, grandkids. And, in order to do that, you have to think differently. You have to do things just a little bit differently as we age. So yeah, but it's an absolute pleasure having you on the Mindset Podcast, Dr. Torkil. And I was trying to look at Amazon Kindle, like, can people get your book in North America, or is it just within Europe? Or
it's published in America and by a US publisher. It's published both in the UK, Great Britain, by a UK publisher, but it's also published in the US by a US publisher. And it's on audiobooks. You have it on your iPhone. You can go on your book app on your iPhone. It's available in a minute, you know. And it's an ebook also. If you prefer to read it on your Kindle or on your iPad or so. So
that's awesome.
Yeah. And then, you can go to thepulsecure.com, because then you can see the video lecture that you saw there. So and on Instagram, on Dr. Torkil, dr.torkil, you can also follow me and try to give some advice.
And I loved your little vacay reel that you did, where you're like doing push-ups and squats on the beach, and it's like somewhere tropical. Where was that?
That was in the Seychelles, Africa. Wow. I was sailing around there in the summer. So
nice. That was awesome.
Yeah, that was a beautiful place.
Yeah, pleasure to have you on the show, and would love to have you on again. Like, heart rate variability is something that everyone should learn. And a lot of people, like, my wife wears a wearable. I wear a wearable. She's got the Apple Watch. I got the Fitbit. My other friend's got his Apple Watch. So a lot of the younger generation and the older generations are using wearables. And it's a really good thing to learn how to do. So, and then what's the best
and
way?
And if you have a wearable, I'm going to say that the Garmin is by far the best one. But, of course, so many people have the Apple Watch. And if you have the Apple Watch, there's an app called Athletic. You know, that's the combination between athlete and analytic. Athletic, that is the best one so far. And you may also be beneficial to go into and point out that you have an atrial fibrillation, because then it will measure more accurately, because the Apple Watch is not measuring good enough, but that will at least improve your readings.
No, for sure. Absolute pleasure having you on the show. And again, like, what's another way for our listeners to connect with you, get to know you, your website?
That would be thepulsecure.com, and Dr. Torkil on Instagram, and then the book is available, you know, on Amazon, anywhere, so that should be possible.
Right on. Awesome. Pleasure having you on the show, Dr. Torkil. It was an absolute honor to be able to speak with you. And again, thanks for being on Mindset.
Thank you, Alex.
All right.
Thanks for tuning into this episode of Mindset. If you liked what you heard, be sure to subscribe, rate, and review us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or YouTube. Your support helps us bring you more inspiring content and expert insights. Join our community on social media at mind.sep on Instagram, at mind-sep on YouTube, and visit our website, Alexander Muir, that's amazonmikeuir.com/blog, for more exclusive resources and updates. Until next time, keep optimizing your mind and body, and see you in the next episode.